23rd of March, 2020. The UK was put into lockdown, and people were told by the Prime Minister Boris Johnson to stay at home. So people stayed at home. Over the next few months, many of us found it hard to comprehend and cope. Imagine, however, if you had a disability as well. What then?
Suddenly, as we all remember, the news is just suddenly flooded with these stories, and I can just remember thinking that it was that first moment where I thought, this is quite serious and this is going to be serious. We really weren't sure. I spoke to some of the managers, and we weren't sure really of what route to take for that week. It very much felt like lockdown was pending, so we decided to close services. And I think initially we put a post on our Facebook and website that said we were going to close for like 3 days, just to try and take stock of things really and explore whether our services were going to be possible. And those 3 days, it escalated so quickly. I think the following week we were then in lockdown, if I remember rightly. But it was, so what was so difficult at that time is that as a day service, where we're very different to like a residential offer, as a day service, we're there for service users and for young people and for adults with disabilities to come and access our service during the day. And we're forever explaining to families and commissioners and the public and funders that what a vital service we are. And then all of a sudden we spend this time explaining that we're a vital service, and suddenly we're a service that can't operate.
Here we go. Let's open up the door. He has what's known as profound and multiple learning difficulties, and he's also on the autism spectrum. In terms of personality, he's a gentle giant. 6'2", hasn't got an aggressive bone in his body, very amenable, but with a small stubborn streak. When he says no, he means no. He has a great sense of humour, especially slapstick, and although he has no social abilities, he likes being around small numbers of people.
Obviously lockdown came.
Yeah.
How was that for you with Rowan? How did that sort of...
So he'd had a week out of routine on holiday, and then he had a week's rest, by which time he was used to the new routine. And as I said, he's already quite amenable. So the change was quite easy in that respect. What was difficult was trying to get across to him that we couldn't see anybody. But he also so he kind of accepted it. But like the rest of the country, we were all getting anxious, we're all getting worried. What's going to happen? How's it going to work through? And Rowan's quite good at picking up on emotion. So if I got anxious or upset, he'd pick up on it. And he got a little bit tense. If Rowan is upset, he sometimes soils himself. And then paints with it. So about once a month, I've been going in and finding, first thing in the morning, that there's poo all around his bedroom, which is you just have to get on with it.
That's the 16th. We decided to lock down because I felt really upset because COVID started and we haven't had it before.
How did you hear about COVID?
On the news. I was in tears with Sarah.
I then had to go into isolation as well, so I went to see her on the Tuesday.
Yeah.
And Hannah was really upset, and all she wanted was a great big hug.
Yeah.
It was horrible, wasn't it?
Yeah, very.
She couldn't.
We couldn't hug each other,
no,
could we?
No, I got it.
And that was really difficult to explain. Yeah, I think those first 2 weeks,
yeah,
were the most stressful 2 weeks.
Yeah.
For everybody.
Yeah, it was.
Were you stressed, Steph?
Yeah.
Yeah.
We just had a shot. Well done. We just had a shot.
He has Down syndrome, amongst other things. He has various health issues, trouble with his breathing and things as well. He has developmental delay as well. We're a single parent family. And he absolutely loves coming here. He's a very strong little boy, strong character, very busy, sort of quite switched on and wants lots of stimulation and entertainment. So this is perfect for him, really.
How was it for you when lockdown happened then?
Well, I thought that it would be quite straightforward for us because we spent the sort of first year of Jesse's life in a kind of lockdown of our own because of his dependence on breathing equipment. But during lockdown, Jesse's had two emergency surgeries to help him with his breathing, so it's been very traumatic actually. He's ended up on ventilation in Addenbrooke's hospital, all of which I've had to do by myself because of COVID.
What's your favourite thing to do?
Lasagna and garlic bread.
Lasagna?
My favourite, eh?
You've got a very naughty tortoise, haven't you, Dennis?
Oh, yeah, I've got a tortoise. It's a little pain in the backside.
He keeps escaping
outside. Jumping out of the pen. He's a little devil.
I see you've got a face mask on at the moment.
Yeah?
Yeah, do you feel all right with that?
Yeah.
Yeah? Do you know why you're wearing your face mask, do you?
We have to, because of virus.
Because of virus, yeah.
Yeah.
And what about, do you have to wash your hands quite regularly?
Yes.
And do you know why you do that?
Because of the virus.
And who told you about the virus? How did you find out about the virus?
On that TV.
And how does that make you feel?
Not very good. So I miss Nansa.
You miss Nansa?
Yeah.
Is it better now you're back then?
Yeah, I am. I am glad I'm back.
My dog, what amazing.
When did you make that?
I've been doing it for weeks.
Is it nice to be back?
Yeah. Lovely.
What did you miss about it while you was at home or?
Bored.
I was bored.
What are you doing there then, Julie?
Doing a name for my friend.
A name?
Yeah.
And that's your friend, is it?
Yes.
Yeah. Oh, that's nice.
Darcy is 6. She is autistic. She has sensory processing disorder and hypermobility. She is quite placid, although we're now finding that her behaviours are getting a little bit more testing. She's certainly finding her feet and her strength now, so we have to be more alert of what she's up to and a little bit more cautious as to what she's doing.
How was lockdown for Darcy?
To start with, it was okay. It was a bit of a novelty. This is nice, we can do our own thing. And thank you. Lots of sensory play. And just going outdoors and doing all the little bits and pieces that we would usually do when we were having holidays. However, we did find with Darcy, as time went on, she did start to regress. So lots of sensory, let me get down, lots of sensory behaviours, lots of repetitiveness, food became an issue, toileting became an issue. We found it very difficult.
I was working at home to start with, as we all were, which seemed quite a novelty to start with, a bit worrying. And then I think as the weeks went on, I started to feel a little bit like I want to get back to work because it just felt quite lonely and missed everybody. So I was quite pleased to get back, although I was a little bit nervous the first few days when I first came back. But it soon felt just good to be amongst colleagues again.
How's the lockdown been for you, sort of, with regards to Nansa, right? Have you, what's your sort of role been?
I think it's just been a different challenge, really. Thinking outside of the box, how can we best provide something for our service users when we're not actually able to see them face to face? It's changed a bit now because we can see some of them face to face. But originally, it was that thinking outside the box, what can I do? What would they be interested in? You know, what will reassure them? Because I think that was part of it. My reasoning for doing lots of videos, which is what I did, was more the fact that we're still here, we know you're there, you know, we still want to have some kind of connection.
Planning for the worst case scenario at the beginning of this perhaps now seems naive, but we were, I think most people were thinking in context of we're planning for 12 weeks. This situation is 12 weeks. And I think everyone knew it would be an ongoing crisis, but I don't think necessarily at the beginning people realised that those interactions and that group support that we provide would be suspended or effectively cancelled for such a long period of time. And then as we started to engage with service users at home, whether that be we set up a project called Nansa at Home, so that involved our support staff filming activities and sessions that we could put on our website, on Facebook, and that our service users and our children and our families, they could all, you know, facilitate that at home. That's when we began to notice how important the support was.
So what was lockdown like for you when you sort of, when it first happened?
It felt like it happened quite suddenly. Obviously, we'd had a procedure in place beforehand, so we knew it was happening, but then it sort to sort of shut suddenly was quite of a shock. It was sort of just, you sort of hit the ground running, like, okay, what are we going to do now? How are we going to carry on supporting from home? So it was a bit of a learning curve. I think it took a couple of weeks to sort of really get the hang of it, and obviously we're trying to understand what's happening, our members are trying to understand, and we're having to try to explain to them as well when we don't even know. And I think that was the hardest bit, is trying to talk to members when you don't have any answers.
I hope everyone's keeping really well and keeping nice and safe. Tim's actually been out on a walk today because it's Travel and Transport Week at Nansa, and he's currently out on a walk on the NDR walk, and he's currently outside Airport. I've seen quite a few planes taken off, and even a few helicopters.
At the minute, I'm editing Tim's riddle that we put up on Facebook. So Tim's a session coordinator, and every week he does a weekly riddle that will go on our Facebook for the members, just to be able to see his face and sort of see what everyone's up to, really. We have different themes each week as well, so that's why he's in an airport, because it's Transport Week.
I'm grainy, that's why I'm not an old photograph. The answer was, it was sand.
Have you sort of had to come up with sort of new innovative ideas? And
yeah, I mean, I started doing this, like working on social media during lockdown, so it's sort of been a learning curve. It is, we used to use social media, I guess, to inform people of certain changes in the charity, but now it's our way of interacting with everyone. So yeah, it's coming up with ways of trying to support through videos. When we do cooking, certain things like having to edit in the peck on the screen or write the words at the bottom, which we would usually be there in person to be able to support with, Whereas now, if our members watching that video by them, I have to assume the members watching it by themselves, what else would they need? If they need a peck on the screen, would they need the words written at the bottom? Would they need it slowed down? So it's that sort of thing, trying to think about it. Because obviously when you're face to face, if they need help understanding something, you can be there to help, but trying to think, okay, how is this going to come across?
Yeah.
What are you going to be doing this morning?
We're going to make some muffins, aren't we?
Yeah. Muffins. Blueberry muffins.
Blueberry muffins. Where's your eyes gone, Luke?
Some of the service users who came to a large centre-based setting before, maybe 40 in a building at once, we're seeing just different personality traits, new levels of confidence, because they're suddenly able to be themselves in smaller groups, and they're having more of a voice and they're heard more.
Sit, well done.
Never been that. Yeah.
Just put the blueberries
down so I can do mine. Do you want
to sign in, Elliot? Yeah.
That one there. That's right, yeah. That one.
Just a little tick.
Squirt.
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 Lovely. You join me in? I can, yeah. You're in, Luke. Great. All good. You're in.
Luke? How often do you wash your hands a day?
Now you need to take your mask off, can't you?
Yeah.
Stop it in your bag.
All the time.
Do you?
Yeah. But at the other now, sir, no one do.
Larry didn't have to then, did we?
No one do. And I do all the time.
All right, Elliot?
Yeah, we do.
Yeah. You washing your hands again?
Yeah.
Why is that?
Every day. Government then said that.
The government said, did they?
Yeah.
And what did they say?
Yeah, safety. Caution and things every day.
There's some paper towels over there.
Sorted.
Do you
want a hand? Awesome day today.
Is it?
Yeah.
So what are you going to do today?
The ingredients.
What time she got porridge? So that
muffins. Things.
Well, I want porridge and muffins.
My favourite some muffins every day.
Hello Jessie. Where are you? Where are you? And Jessie says, here I am. How do you do?
Prior to COVID, I was running the sensory sessions for Nansa's Family Services. After we get through this period, I will be helping with the School for Parents, hence the change. Which would have happened in April, had COVID not hit.
There's been a lot of things being ordered in for art and craft stuff that people can send out, that we've been able to deliver to people's homes so that people have got things to do at home. So this tends to be the room that we do that work in to make the parcels up to send to people.
And who's delivering those?
The support staff. I've done it as well, but any staff that are available that there was more staff to available to start with before we started doing the outreach, so we made sure that everyone had something to do. But basically, some of the support staff are doing that in between doing their outreach work as well.
Okay, so you say that you you took some out.
I did.
Yeah, and sort of how was that received?
Do you know, it was great to be able to see the members. They were very pleased to see me, and as they've been to see other people, it's been a lifeline.
What have you got? A present from Nansa. Open it up. Ooh, some colours. Wow.
Don't use that voice. Okay.
A book.
Not only to receive the packs and to have things to do, but to have that contact with the staff, so they just feel that Nance is still there for them, and that we're still doing the work that we can with them.
Most of us are able to understand and kind of manage our anxieties based on what's actually happening. And the capacity to understand for young children or for adults with learning disabilities, it goes without saying there needs to be an additional element of support there. So for example, something like wearing a mask to you or I could be a sense of we're obviously doing that to protect ourselves and protect others, using sanitizer. But for some of our service users, it could be a case of, well, I don't need to use the sanitizer because I haven't got the virus. Why do I have to wear the mask? And those precautions in themselves become real cause for anxiety in a lot of our service users.
One-to-one sessions, and sticking to one-to-one sessions for now, and it's up to parents if they feel able to come back to the centre. Lots of parents have, and it's been lovely seeing the parents and the children again. And we've done it very socially distanced. We've had masks on or visors, depending on whether the child can socially distance or not. So we've looked at each individual case to see how we can do that safely. Some children were still shielding, and so we've arranged Zoom calls for them. So we've done a session via Zoom with myself or another leader, and just that child and parent or carer. So I think both options have worked really well. And it's been really nice to just get back to some proper sort of practice and meeting the needs of those children. So thinking about all of the learning areas that they might need a bit of support with. So thinking about their sort of the motor learning, the cognitive learning, communication, things like that, and really sort of starting to think about how we can address those within a different session, different setup, but at the same time, still beneficial to the families and the children.
What colour is it now?
Everybody has had support through activity ideas and things to do at home, and trying to come up with things that we would usually do in a session that they can do at home with everyday equipment sort of thing. I've also, had more personalised emails back and forth where people have asked for extra support with behaviours and things that are going on at home. And then those that have also wanted phone support, a bit more of a chat, because a lot of people are feeling so isolated throughout this period.
Because he's not got social skills. And one thing that Nance was really, really good at, is really good at, is social stuff. And he was getting loads of it because he was going to the youth club. He was doing stuff on Saturdays with them. He was going to day service with them 2 days a week. He was not getting that practice. To get back into the practice of that was really, really good for him. And he's picked up. He's enjoying it. I never have any trouble waking him up on days for Nance.
Darcy started coming to Nansa when she was 2.5 years old, and she came with her younger sister Minnie, and we've been coming ever since. So much so that when Darcy finished and went to school, I then took a job here. I couldn't stay away. It's like a second home to us. I can bring all of my children here. There's activities for all of them. Nobody gets left out. And the planning that the staff put into these sessions is amazing. the children don't ever want to leave. They've actually asked if they can sleep over. and what's upstairs for? Isn't that for bedrooms? So they'd love to stay.
How is everyone? Alice, you? Yeah, you good? Karen, how are you?
Alright, I suppose.
You're alright.
So we've been doing Zoom sessions pretty much since probably second or third week of lockdown. We've progressed from having a Zoom member catch up on a Monday. We've then built up to an actual online session on a Wednesday. And we're now expanded that to having three online sessions in the week, as well as a member catch up during those sessions. So now we're having the challenge of setting up sessions online, which we'd usually do in the building. So it's been a bit of a challenge as a session coordinator setting up. For example, today we've got karaoke on, which we'd usually have all the members in the building, but instead we've currently got them on Zoom, looking at a computer screen and hopefully being able to join in interactively online instead.
How are they finding anything?
I've been quite surprised how well they have adapted to being able to use Zoom. Some of them better than some people actually know outside of Nansa, which has been really good. So some people have really come out of their shells on Zoom as well, and we're actually being able to see another side to some people as well. Stacey's on it. Come on, Sammy.
What's happening with your face mask, Luke?
Nothing. Oh well.
What have you been doing, Luke? When during this coronavirus thing, what have you been doing? You been at home?
Yeah.
Has that been hard?
No.
And what do you think about having to wear a mask?
Easy.
So, trying to figure out the way for the group to be making the same thing, but keeping safety in mind, we've got to separate out all of the mixture beforehand to do the weights and measures. So the guys aren't all touching the same equipment when they're working. Mm. So Mel's measuring out each individual portion. Normally the guys would do it themselves.
Mm. The boxes and the equipment, they'll just have their own individual set of ingredients that they can then put into the bowl. So they'll still have a lovely time, but we've took away a little bit of the independence because they can't share things because we're trying to keep them apart.
Do they sort of notice that or?
I think definitely Luke, because he's already said today, well, I normally weigh out my ingredients, but I've tried to explain to him that I need to do it just so that not everyone's touching the same packaging.
You're what, sorry?
I'm usually measuring mine, eh?
Yeah.
And do you know why you can't measure out today?
That's because she's doing it.
Yeah.
That I heard.
Yeah.
She say, she measuring everything out.
Just to make sure we don't all touch the same things and spread germs about.
Yeah. I don't get germs.
No.
Other people might. I don't.
So with all the cleaning routines, do you have to be sort of flexible with everybody?
Yeah, we're just kind of, every once in a while, we've got to go around, give everything a little bit of a wipe and a clean, and obviously before any activities and things as well. And work around where people are as well, rather than shifting everyone about, because obviously if one person's been sitting in the same seat for a while, then it's not being used by someone else. So we tend to go around, just give all the open surfaces a bit of a wipe every once in a while, and then at the end of the day, the shower curtains we're using as covers on our absorbent surfaces all go into the wash at the end of the day, ready for the next day.
Obviously with guys having different disabilities and different needs and what have you, how are you finding that then? Because
some of the guys are quite aware or have an idea of why we do what we do and why things have been the way they have the last few months. And obviously some people don't understand it at all. They just have to kind of adapt. Well, we have to adapt, and they've been adapting to the kind of change in circumstances. And it might seem a bit strange, but we all kind of eventually fall into our new way of doing things. Yeah.
And do they seem to be adapting?
I think because this is a whole new Nansa as well, we've been calling it Little Nansa, so that the guys get used to the name of the place and where we are. But many of the adults have never seen this part of Nansa services, because normally it's got the kids in it. But this is one of our separate bubbles, so that we can keep delivering services to who we can.
Quite shocking, really. Some of the comments like, we're really struggling at home, we really need these services, or thank you so much, this video is like the highlight of my week. And I think we really began to, again, feel we are a vital service. We just can't operate as we normally would during this time. And some of the testimonials and the messages we've received from families and adults have really been quite poignant. And yeah, it continues to be a difficult period. But I think the big difference between now and the beginning is, I think we all have a clearer understanding that this new normal could continue and persist for some time. And I think we haven't seen the end of how we will need to adapt.
Well, I was in Parliament for 18 and a half years representing North Norfolk, and I announced last summer that I would stand down at the next general election, which then came sooner than perhaps expected. But I announced at the time of my decision to stand down that we wanted to set up a Norfolk Mental Health Fund. So that's what Mary, my wife, and I have done. We put in some money to get it started. We're now up to over 160,000. We want to grow it much further. The purpose of the fund is to support the brilliant community-based organisations that work in our county, supporting children, teenagers and young adults, particularly in mental health, in learning disability and in autism.
Another blast, because we've been drinking as well and we've been touching our faces.
So I'm still drinking.
Oh, okay. Well, if you finish up your drink, Luke, and then we'll all have a bit of a hand scrub before.
So,
we start.
Elliot, you do your hands first. Yeah. What are you doing? Dad, no, he's gone. He's got the back on the wall, hasn't he?
He's been quite fixed on those pictures today.
Yeah, there you go. They're all clean.
Yeah.
Oh, shame!
Well,
Craig, please.
Milk and oats.
Set
aside for 20 minutes. So,
Recipe.
That's,
yeah, well, we can have a look
at
that in a little while.
I usually melt the butter.
It's bits in that one.
Yeah, so what you need to do is.
So that can go into the big bowl.
You can put the spoon in and I'll give it a little mix around.
Yeah.
Yeah, because that honey's going to be very
sticky.
There
we go. Together? Yeah, together?
Yeah.
Big mix.
No. What's it done? Look at that, Craig. Look at that.
No.
So obviously you're having separate tables at the moment then?
Yes, we would have normally all worked together at the day service. But no, we have to all be separate, have our own separate spoons and bowls, don't we, Ben?
Yeah.
I mean, sometimes when we're doing a mix like this, because we're doing like 1.5 times of the mixture, so they don't have too many muffins. They would literally share everything. So that maybe one would start weighing out something and we'd just move the bowl along, you know, and then at the end just all share the big mixture. But obviously we can't do that now. And we make sure that those guys have got different colour muffin cases so they don't go home with the wrong muffins.
No.
Yeah.
Teamwork.
Dreamwork, teamwork. I do like your sayings, Elliot.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, it is. Great. The table's in the way. Mm. Oh. That means I'm 2 metres away.
This far, this way is 2 metres.
Oh, no way!
Yeah, I'll do that.
When I said about the distance, Craig, Elliot said about government.
Yeah.
Did a lot of the guys say that?
Yeah, I've heard a few people say because Boris said so. And a lot of people say, yeah, because of the government. I think that when the briefings were on, a lot of families obviously have been watching it together. Or people in their supported living, and they've seen it. And that's kind of, I guess, how it's been explained. Because speaking to Luke and Elliot, I think they know that they're what they need to do, but not quite the detail.
Craig?
Yes, Luke?
Did you want to help with the wiping up for you?
Yes, you can do, mate. I think there's some fresh tea towels in here.
Do you know why you have to keep your 2 metres?
Yeah.
Why is that?
I don't know the word.
Yeah.
I don't know the word.
What was it for?
2 metres. Keep 2 metres away.
What, social distancing?
Yeah.
Yeah? Do you know what it means? And why we do it?
So you don't get a disease.
Yeah.
In my time as an MP, I came across so many families, either who had experienced mental ill health or who had a child with a learning disability or an autistic child. And so often families face impossible challenges, particularly with statutory services, with long waiting times. And people rely on these brilliant community-based organisations to support them. And they often intervene much earlier than the statutory services do.
Oh, stringy. Jane, get it.
Is it nice to be out, Paul?
Do you like being out?
Yeah.
Paul, like going on our walks? And what else do we do? We play... Uno.
Yeah.
And you like doing that?
Yeah.
Yeah? Have you got Uno?
You know, I think by collaborating, by bringing together all of the skills and the resources we've got in Norfolk, we can maximise our effectiveness.
Most of what we do already is working in partnership with other charities. You know, we're a small organisation. We are kind of specialists in what we do. There aren't many other people who do similar things to us. So it makes a lot of sense for us to be working in partnership with other charities to go to them, people like Nansa, to provide a specialist service for their service users and their clients. That's definitely the way to go. It also just makes it more kind of sustainable. It's really informal, it's really bespoke, it's about the experience that the individual has in that session with the other people and with the music lead, just experiencing it and enjoying making music.
So at the moment we've just basically linked up, we've been to a few coffee groups, I've been and met some of the team, and we've just done some chatting about sort of organisations and where we could go forward together. But we're coming on to the All Aboard project so that we can offer a coffee group clinic for Nansa families as well. We've been talking for a while about what we can do together to kind of give more of a package to families, and this sort of has just come around. I think we were going to try and get it all up and running for September, so COVID's impacted the start time for it, but it was always on the cards that we wanted to do some work together.
That's what's a real challenge for us at the moment. It's about how our members feel like members, how they feel like they're part of this thing. And obviously some of our service users have multiple friendship groups, and that's such a challenge to facilitate now.
Should we tell Andy what we're doing? Andy, Ralph is going to make a mobile of wild animals. And what animal is this one?
Leopard.
It's on a leopard so far. What else have we got on the table? His favourite animals, aren't they? Zoo animals. What have we got there?
Zebra.
Right. And how do you sign zebra?
Zebra.
Well done.
It goes without saying that at the beginning of the crisis, I was very, very concerned about the viability of the charity moving forward. But perhaps looking on the more positive side, what I don't think anyone was prepared for was this sense of kind of a new sense of the importance of health and social care services. I think that it really brought the country together.
It was very, very friendly with Rowan, and they get on really well together. I think they used to do, what days do they do? I think they do Fridays and Wednesdays at the adult centre. But Ralph settled in really well, haven't you, Ralph? Ralph's quite shy, aren't you? Are you being silly? Are you being shy? Are you being shy?
It's difficult not seeing the members, but I'd say the main thing that sort of intruded on me and Paul to begin with was him getting used to me wearing a face mask.
Oh, well,
because he kind of relies on my facial expression. Okay. But now it's very much, it's all done by voice and me doing things slowly for him to fully understand. I feel like he's got used to it now.
Uh-oh! No! I've got
bigger
too! There we go.
No!
Are you looking, Andy?
I am.
Baba!
Did you win?
Yeah!
Oh, well done, Paul!
And I think that what this has shown is actually people have a newfound respect for health and social care and for services such as those that Nansa provides. So in terms of fundraising, we may not be out running marathons and doing parachute jumps, but there has been an astonishing amount of support coming from local businesses and local grant making trusts, specifically tailoring awards for charities like Nansa to respond to COVID-19. And that's enabled us to adapt. There's been more support there than perhaps we would have felt there would have been at the beginning.
We were first introduced to Nansa when they were awarded a grant from the Masonic Charitable Foundation in 2018 for just over £70,000 over 3 years to help with a sleep project. So I was fortunate enough to come down and present the cheque to them. And it was the first time I saw the facilities they'd got here. We spent an hour and a half, 2 hours with the people, and we were overwhelmed by the fantastic work that they do. And to be truthful, they stole the hearts of all those who were here. So when we heard from Leon that they'd hit a, a hole in the funding because of the COVID-19, we again contacted the central charity. We are just overwhelmed by the terrific work they do here and just delighted to be able to support them.
I'm really concerned about, you know, future funding of all sorts of really important activities. I'm worried also about charities that rely on giving from people, because so many people are now stretched financially themselves and will feel less able to contribute to charity. So I think charities potentially face a pretty challenging time financially, just at a time when they're needed probably more than ever.
Oh dear! What are you like?
I think that I'm grateful Nansa is positioned within the health and social care sector, because I think that the need is there. Our services are vital, so we just have to get more creative about how we raise the funds in order to continue. And so in the immediate, I haven't got the financial concerns here, August 2020, that I suspected we would have at the beginning of this, but I'm certainly not wanting to become complacent. You know, we are a charity and we survive and we continue on the goodwill of people willing to donate and to support our projects. And so we need to make sure that those projects are needed, that we can demonstrate how important they are, and hopefully that support continues.
Ready to go again, ready and up.
Please help Nansa to navigate the new normal. To donate £3, text New Nansa to 70331. To donate £5, text New Nansa to 70970. And to donate £10, text New Nansa to 70191. Text will be charged at your standard network rate. For full terms and conditions, please see easydonate.org. Thank you.